Slide number one, how to make breaching intrusion difficult by the reinforcement of the doors and windows in your house, apartment, or condominium. In addition to this reinforcement, we'll talk about the deterrence factors of outside lighting, home alarm systems, and entry door monitoring. Bear in mind that no domestic structure is absolutely impervious to intrusion. But by this seminar, we would hope to make you aware of the possibility of making your entry portals hard enough, quote-unquote, to discourage an intruder or intruders from attempting a break-in, or at least give you time to proceed to a self-planned place of safety to notify authorities or to defend yourself if you so choose to do so. Door frames and door jams. Picture 1 shows typical door frame construction using 2x4 studs. A 2x4 stud is a piece of lumber 1.5 inches thick and 3.5 inches wide. It can be up to 10 feet long. Notice that, for added strength, there are double 2x4 studs comprising each side of the door frame. Picture 2 shows the door jamb, usually made out of 1-inch by 4-inch hardwood. Picture 3 shows the dark-lined door jamb inserted and nailed into the door frame. Picture 3 also suggests that the door frame and house frame are comprised of 2x6 studs, 1.5 inches by 5.5 inches, which occurs rarely, is expensive, but results in a very strong door frame and wall. We see the door anatomy of an entry door. We discover that there are names to the various pieces of wood or planking that make up the construction of a solid wood door, or any door for that matter. The latch style board and the hinge style board are important because they take the brunt of the job in resisting a forced entry, as the knob set, deadbolt, and hinges are installed on these boards. Notice that the windows in this door, lighting the entry foyer, are small and at the very top. If your concern is primarily security, this is about as much glass as you should have in your entry doors. Rule of thumb: the type of door construction applied to entry doors cannot be overlooked or taken for granted. Picture 1 is a hollow core door. The hollow core door is the most insecure of all doors that we are covering, so they only serve as interior doors in homes, apartments, and condominiums. They are composed of wooden stiles and rails with a thin wood grain skin over a cardboard honeycomb core. One swift kick and these doors collapse. Picture 2 is a solid core door composed of glued wood blocks or composite material that you see in countertops. We call it fiberboard. Picture number 3 is representative of the construction of a domestic steel-clad door. The thickness of the knob set and hinge styles and the thickness skin are relative to the quality and cost of the door. Picture number 4 is a commercial steel door. The airspace between the steel skin on all steel doors is filled with foam insulation to retain heat or cold within the home. The styles and rails are thick, formed metal channels, with the steel skin being about 18 gauge in thickness. Almost no website will tell the metal thickness of the skin of their domestic steel-clad doors. So before purchasing a steel-clad door, determine the thickness of the steel skin. The thicker the steel skin, the higher the quality, strength, and cost of the door. Numerically, the lower the gauge number, the thicker the steel. You will see a table in your email. Various styles of solid wood doors. If you choose double doors as your front door, a steel center post between the two is ideal. We do not know the relative strength of double doors as opposed to single doors, but a center post is important to security. Some center posts are removable for moving furniture. The montage of pictures to the bottom left reflects a number of steel-clad entry door styles. In a security-dedicated situation, we would not recommend the doors with the most glass, as heavy objects such as stone statues and figurines, stone benchtops, stone pottery, wrought iron furniture, and the like can be thrown through the glass areas to gain entry to the house. Picture 1 is an oval inlaid stained glass entry door with accompanying glass side panels. Picture 2 is a set of glass double patio doors with identical full-sized side panels. As elegant as the doors are in Picture 1 and Picture 2, elegance is their only feature, as they offer no security. In Picture 2, one sees what appears to be heavy patio furniture outside the doors, which can be thrown through the glass to gain entry. Picture 3 appears to be a solid glass storm door. In the installation of this type of door, whether it be glass or plexiglass, decorative decals should be placed to prevent anyone from trying to walk or run through the glass, thinking that it is an open door. In Picture 1, the handmade iron doors have 1/2 inch thick iron decorative latticework in front of the glass. To provide security, the ironwork has to be evaluated by the buyer. Also, a center post would increase security if the doors are double doors. Picture 2 represents a decorative wrought iron or steel security door. These doors are valuable in greatly enhancing the security of entry doors, as they add another barrier that opens outwards. Picture 3 shows a double set of steel security doors for what is probably a patio entrance. These also open outwards and are set in a steel frame anchored in the brick. Picture 4 shows a brass cuff that prevents a hand from reaching through the bars and turning the deadbolt handle. Better security would be the use of the double-keyed deadbolt, which we will cover shortly. In Picture 1, we see a kicked-in door. Notice that both the deadbolt and the lock set did not prevent the deadbolt and lock set striker from bursting through the door jamb. The reason why is there is only about 1 inch of wood that hold the striker plates in place. Picture 1A shows in red the anti-credit card device on the knob set striker. It's best not to depend on these, but install a deadbolt lock. Picture 2 shows a side view with the kicked out piece of door jamb held in place for illustration. In Picture 3, we see commercially available reinforcement material that will enclose the exposed part of the door jamb. As number 3 suggests, measuring the center-to-center distance that separates the knob set from the deadbolt should be done and should be matched up with your purchase of reinforcement material. Picture 4 shows door reinforcement plates for the deadbolt and the knob set. Picture 1 is a schematic on how to measure lock backset. If the hole for the lock is already drilled, measure from the center of the hole to the edge of the door. On the lock, measure from the tailpiece insert to the deadbolt faceplate. Most interior doors are a 2 3/8 inch backset, and most front or exterior doors are B, a 2 3/4 inch backset. The backset measurement must be determined before purchasing a lock. Picture number 2 shows us a door jamb brass plate striker plate in a long brass strip. Notice the cutouts for the knob set and the deadbolt strikers. We see the screw holes drilled in the strip ready to receive the 3-inch screws. Remember, match the diameter of the old 3/4 inch screws that you remove with the new 3-inch screws that you will purchase at the hardware store. Picture 3 shows a reinforced knob set striker plate with a door closing adjustment tab. If this type of striker plate fits over the original striker plate, Then this adjustment tab can be broken off, as the adjustment tab on the original striker plate will continue to adjust the tightness of the door. Picture 4 shows us a reinforced deadbolt strike plate with 3-inch screws in the kit. Note the red dots where the 3-inch screws should go. Rule of thumb: install applications with small screws first until your alignment is perfect, and then drill and install 3-inch screws while leaving the new application in place. We have a hardware store variety combination strike plate. Notice that the cutouts provide for the knob set and the deadbolt, and there are 2 flanges which provide for a top or bottom positioning of the knob set. Notice that in picture 1, the center to center measurement of the striker holes is 3 5/8 to 4 inches. Again, don't forget to measure this critical distance before you buy a strike plate, and take your measuring tool to the hardware store with you. In picture 2, the red dots represent the placement of the 3-inch screws, and the green dots are for whatever screws are provided less than 3 inches long. In picture 3, instead of using 3-inch screws, a 3-inch channel slides into a hole drilled in the door jamb and door frame. Picture 1 in the slide presents some nice sliding glass doors, but we see some wrought iron furniture and objects outside on the patio, as flower pots and wrought iron furniture can be picked up and thrown through the glass. The barbecue grill can be used as a battering ram. Picture 2 shows a device that most people use to prevent casual entry through sliding glass doors, and that is a piece of broomstick, dowel, or an adjustable bar placed in the slide channel. Most factory finger locks on sliding glass doors are quite flimsy, and in addition, the sliding glass door can be lifted out of its track and moved to one side. Picture 3 is a locking bar. The bar is locked by pushing down on the center of the bar as shown. This makes lifting out the door quite difficult, but there is no guarantee that it cannot be done with or without breaking the glass. Again, no locking device prevents the breakage of the glass to gain entry in either doors or windows. Picture 1 is a sliding glass door pin. It is larger than a window pin. Picture 2 shows where the pins must be fixed in both the vertical styles of the fixed side of the door and the sliding side of the door. 2 pins must be used to prevent rotation of the door in an attempted lift out of the door. Picture 3 shows steel patio security doors, as we have seen before. Let's read the security considerations from the slide. Use 2 door pins to prevent rotation and lift out. Dual pins work in conjunction with quality locks. If glass is broken, both pins can be removed. Consider multiple layers of sliding door security: quality locks, dual door pins, expandable door bar, steel storm doors, glass breaker alarm sensor, door breach alarm sensor, motion sensor in the room in case of lift out. Caution: do not drill through the outer style when installing door pins, as the pin can be located and pushed out from outside the door. Door locks and hinges. Most of these pictures should be familiar. Picture 1 shows us a common lock set or knob set and its striker plate with curved flange for the beveled striker. Picture 2 shows us a single-keyed deadbolt, meaning that the outside opens with a key and the inside opens with a turn handle. If you have glass panels adjacent to the deadbolt, you should not use this lock. Picture 3 shows us a double-keyed deadbolt to be used when any door glass is within an arm's length of the lock. It is best that the bolt throw be 1 inch, meaning that the bolt moves forward 1 inch into the strike plate. Picture 4 shows us a common deadbolt strike plate. The quickest way to reinforce your front door is to replace the 2 short screws in the deadbolt strike plate with 3-inch screws of the same diameter. Pictures 5, 6, and 7. If kicking in the door locks don't work, the criminal will probably try kicking in the door hinges. Again, replace the short hinge screws on each hinge with 3-inch screws of the same diameter. If your door opens outward, another way to get in is to remove the hinge pins and simply take the door off. Picture 5 shows a common interior door hinge with removable pins. Picture 6 shows the hinge pin secured by a set screw. Picture 7 shows us an exterior door hinge with a stud and receiver hole. The stud is colored red and the receiver hole is colored yellow. If the pins are removed when the door is closed, the door cannot be pulled out at the hinge side because the stud is seated and prevents the separation of the hinges. In picture 1, we have a vertical, foot-operated, sprung door bolt that has the striker plate mounted into the floor. To make them effective, there must be an identical, hand-operated door bolt with the strike plate mounted directly opposite the floor bolt. In picture 2 are decorative slide bolts designed for eye appeal only and are much too light for security. In picture 3, we have a light-duty barrel bolt of 3 to 4 inches in length. These are used for minimum security and can be easily kicked in. In picture 4, we have a heavy barrel bolt that usually is available from 6 to 10 inches long. Notice letter A. A padlock hole has been provided in the bolt channel. To the right, in black letters, is a bolt strike that in any case can be screwed only into the door jamb, which is not desirable, and not into the door frame itself, which is desirable. This is not secure. The secure bolt strike is letter B in picture 4 because it mounts on the surface of the door jamb and the red dot screw holes are for 3-inch matched screws. These pass through the door jamb into the door frame. In picture 4, the black line on B, we notice that the striker hole extends out into the room to meet the bolt. For maximum security, the green dots represent machine screws that go completely through the door and secure with nuts on the inside. The outside of the door shows only the heads of the machine screws, or for the best application, use one-way screws, item C. One-way screws are hard to find, so regular slotted screws can be used and should be a full half inch longer than apparently required because a screw that is too short will not do the job and a long screw can be cut off after the nut is tightened down on the inside. So you can use regular slotted machine screws that are 1/2 inch longer than anticipated that have a slotted screw head that can be filed smooth. The alternative would be a deadbolt lock with the strike plate installed with 3-inch screws. Picture 1 is a padlock with a cut-resistant circular shank. Picture 2 shows laminated padlocks with various lengths of shanks. These are for low security situations as they are not resistant to bolt cutters. Picture 3 shows us a keyed plus keypad knob set combination lock and a keyed plus keypad deadbolt. In considering the purchase of either of these two locks, one would have to ask, why am I buying a keypad lock when the keyed lock can be picked? Picture 4 shows a Medico brand deadbolt lock, which is professed to be bump-proof and pick-proof. These deadbolts cost about $200. Picture 5 shows us a vertical deadbolt. The bolt at the arrow, instead of going in and out of the door frame, goes vertically through a surface mount strike plate. These locks prevent the spreading of the door frame by crowbars. That is, jamming a crowbar into the space between the edge of the door and the door jamb to crack and bend the door and the door frame more than 1 inch to extract a locked deadbolt from its striker hole and thus open the door. Notice the red lines suggesting that if these locks are purchased, try and find one with a strike plate that reaches into the door edge space to allow 3-inch screws to penetrate through the door jamb into the door frame. Equally as good is to use this type of lock in combination with a deadbolt. Picture 6 shows a totally digital deadbolt lock, which apparently makes very good sense. This lock sacrifices a key override, but has a surface mount striker plate that can easily be kicked off. Picture 7 suggests the ideal key grind or shape as being a, quote, high-low or low-high grind, arrows A and B. Also shown is how the tumbler or cylinder can turn, letter D, to open the door when the correct key is inserted and the pins are matched at the shear interface, letter C. Obviously, the driver pins and the tumbler pins will present an uneven combination at the shear interface C if the key is removed or the incorrect key is inserted, resulting in the shear interface being obstructed by the pins and therefore locked in place. My locksmith suggested this key pattern to me and said that if I kept the lock well lubricated with WD-40, with this low-high key pattern, lock bumping, quote-unquote, would be difficult and be at the skill level of a professional thief. Picture 1 shows a common hardware store manual vertical rise sliding bar garage door lock. Vertically opening garage door rails have slots already punched out for the bar on this lock. Note the padlock hole, which should be utilized by inserting a good quality padlock. These simple, labor-intensive garage door locks with padlock holes should be installed on both sides of the garage door, as these provide the best security. Picture 2 shows a standard manual garage door lock, but keyed and accessible from the outside. This lock can be picked or forced from the outside and allow the retracting of the sliding bar that is not padlocked. Picture 3 shows a battery-powered, motorized dual garage door lock with remote control. This makes everything easy, but the remote signaling system and the signaling system that raises and lowers your garage door by remote control is susceptible to signaling devices carried by sophisticated criminals that generate the specific frequencies in your handheld remote. Picture 4 shows a garage to house or front entry door. It is a steel-clad, insulation-filled entry door and should be kick-proof. Notice the position of the glass on the door, which is high at the top, preventing access to either the knob set or the deadbolt. As we begin our presentation on domestic windows, we see in picture A a window frame constructed into a wall frame. We also see that it is constructed like a door frame, with double 2x4s comprising each side. In picture B, the window frame cutaway, we see the side window jamb and the double-hung window inserted into the frame. Also in picture B, the two little arrows point to the side window stiles. In picture C, the arrow points to the inside of the window jamb. In picture D, we see another view of a double-hung window with the large arrow pointing to the outside of the window jamb, and the two little arrows again pointing to the lower half window stiles. In the double-hung windows shown on this slide, the upper half of the window lowers down and the lower half of the window raises up. In some newer construction windows, the upper half of the window is fixed and not movable, with only the lower half of the window capable of being opened. Note, many criminals prefer windows for illegal entry, as windows are a softer target than doors. However, gaining entry through a reinforced window usually requires breaking the glass. A reinforced window should slow down the criminal and give the homeowner added time to react by forcing the criminal to make some noise in breaking the window and clearing the glass before entry. This is all the more reason to have an alarm system monitored glass breaker, quote-unquote, device and a window breach sensor, quote-unquote, device in each room. Picture 1 represents a window latch or catch, which is not a lock. Picture 2 shows the simplest means of preventing illegal entry through double-hung windows. It is an adjustable window bar that prevents the raising of the lower half of the window. The window bar does not prevent the lowering of the upper half of the window. An effective window bar does not prevent a criminal from breaking the window and removing the bar. Picture 3 shows a window pin. Picture 4 shows, by the red dots, where to drill to insert the pins. Now the pins must penetrate part of the upper stile, and they must go all the way through the lower window stiles. You cannot drill all the way through the upper window stile, or the window pin can be pushed out from the outside of the house. The window pins prevent both halves, the upper half and the lower half of the double-hung window, from being opened if the pin penetration is correct. Notice the warnings on the slide. Picture 1 shows a sliding window lock with the window open and the lock scissored up. In the middle section, the window is closed with the bar lock in place. In the third section, the window lock is depressed into place. Picture 2 shows a small child and a childproof window guard. Window guards keep the children in, but will keep no one out, as they can be easily kicked in. Picture 3 shows a swingable, lockable window bar that will allow fire egress if the key is available. We have to say that this device can probably be kicked in. Picture 4 shows a permanent adjustable window bar that can be installed with 3-inch screws through the side window jambs to access the window frame stud. The problem with installing permanent window bars is that there is no fire egress. Some people have casement windows in their homes instead of the double hung type. If security in a casement window is a consideration, we would certainly encourage the installment of double latches, as in number 1 and number 2 pictures. Two latches would make prying the window open more difficult. You may consider an inside window bar that fits horizontally across the windows. Again, when dealing with security in windows, any window latch or lock will not prevent glass breakage and subsequent illegal entry. You can purchase separate latches, as in picture 4 and picture 5. Picture 6 shows us a casement window that opens inwards. These windows are difficult to secure, as almost any lock installed on inward opening casement windows can be easily kicked in. An inside bar going across these windows seems to be the answer from a security perspective. Our impression of window shutters is that exterior shutters are good for keeping out stormy weather, and interior shutters are for decorative purposes. Exterior shutters that we could find do not impress us as providing any security, as the exterior hinges on the shutter could be unscrewed without making any noise. Therefore, interior hinge installation and barrel bolts would seem to be mandatory from a security perspective. The only shutter lock we could suggest would be a large barrel bolt which is locked from the inside. Of the shutters we could find and the type of locks and latches that apply, we can only say that exterior deterrent to illegal window entry, that is, slowing the criminal down and causing him to make extra noise before he has to defeat the window behind the shutter. Pictures 1 through picture 5 show different types of single and double board and batten shutters. Picture 6 shows interior plantation type shutters. Picture 7 shows an interior rotating shutter bar that rotates to a vertical position when the shutters are open. This shutter bar seems to offer the best available security for shutters, but due to the light construction of the shutters, we do not see a great level of security in interior shutters. Picture 8 shows an interior shutter latch, and picture 9 shows an exterior shutter hinge that, if installed, would allow the shutter to be simply lifted off the window. Picture 10 shows a common hook and eye latch, usually used on interior shutters. Again, the better decision for security would be to install the hinges and barrel bolts on the inside of the shutter. Interior hinges probably would not permit opening the shutters 180 degrees outwards, that is, flat against the outside of the house, unless you installed special angled hinges. Permanent window bars and shrubbery and trees. In using permanent window bars, the homeowner has exerted a maximum effort in obtaining window security. To achieve this high degree of security, permanent iron or steel alloy window bars must be mounted to either the wood window frame or the concrete or brick facing of the building, as in picture 1. In picture 2, these surface mount iron window bars may not be very difficult to pry off, especially if they are anchored in stucco. For shrubbery and trees, there are a number of equally important pointers to remember. As you can see from the picture, your property must be clearly visible from the street to help the police visually check out your property when they pass by in their patrol cars. This also means trimming your trees 7 feet up from the ground. If you have a security fence for your front yard, the ideal fence is 8 feet high and does not block the view from the street. To make sure no one can hide behind the shrubbery by your front door, trim it down to a height of 3 feet only. An excellent idea for increasing window security is to plant thorny shrubs under the windows that are at least 3 to 4 feet high, and make sure the shrubs are planted tight up against the house. We would also suggest that the shrubs be extended 2 to 3 feet on either side of the window. Thorny bushes like rose shrubs, barberry, and hawthorn are suggested by our research to plant under windows. Tall trees next to the house should be trimmed 10 feet back from each window to prevent burglars from accessing your second floor level. Now some basic information about safe rooms in the home. Two types of safe rooms are considered. Picture 1 shows an upstairs bedroom safe room with bullet-resistant fiberglass or Kevlar walls. Picture 2 shows a vault-type safe room, purchased in kit form, made of steel, which is suitable for the garage or the basement. Let's read from the slide. Picture 1 shows a steel casement door, and Picture 2 and Picture 3 show how the casement is bolted to a solid or hollow cinder block wall. Picture 4 shows the steel skeleton of the steel door. Picture 5 shows a vault-type safe room kit ready for shipment. Picture 1 shows a pallet of cinder blocks. Picture 2 shows how to construct a strong cinder block wall. The red line shows the overlapping cinder blocks. The green areas show the hollow spaces in the cinder blocks to be filled with concrete. The black line shows the position of reinforced concrete bar known as rebar. This wall is impervious to handgun bullets. Use only the strongest and highest quality concrete mix and mortar. Picture 3 shows a cinder block safe room being constructed on a house concrete slab. Note, cinder block walls are not impervious to terrorist bombs, high-power rifle bullets, or vehicle crashes. First or second floor safe rooms provide quick access at night without running through the house to the basement, making the youngest children's remodeled bedroom. The safe room eliminates the difficult task of moving sleeping children to another room in the middle of the night in case of emergency. Safe room supplies could be stored in a locked closet in this particular bedroom. Also, in this closet could be a handgun stored in a locked, dedicated strong box bolted to the floor, giving two layers of security against curious children and teenagers. The obvious dividing line between a basement safe room and an upstairs safe room is a factor of the weight of the building materials. Therefore, bedroom safe rooms have to be constructed around a reinforced wood frame, employing light, bullet-resistant materials like Kevlar or fiberglass paneling in the walls and floor. Picture 1 shows a steel or paneled safe room assembled during the construction of a new home. Picture 2 is a schematic of fiberglass, Kevlar, or other bullet-resistant paneling comprising the walls and ceiling of a safe room. Picture 3 shows pallets of bullet-resistant fiberglass paneling ready for purchase or shipment. Picture 4 appears to be a universal steel safe room door that apparently is light enough to install in a first or second floor safe room. The wooden door frame supporting a safe room door on the first or second floor must be thoroughly reinforced with extra 2x4s or 2x6s. There are many hyperlinks on safe rooms in your provided email. Our opinion on safe rooms. Safe rooms should be independent from house support systems. The logic of safe rooms is to provide an impregnable family room in the face of weather events or home invasion. The door should remain open and then locked from the inside. Your research must determine if the safe room can withstand any physical attempt to reach the family, including gunfire. The intent is for the family to secure themselves, notify authorities, and then be rescued. Basement safe rooms should not collapse if the house is leveled in a weather event. The problem with basement safe rooms and weather events is that the safe room can be covered with debris that blocks the door if the house does collapse. A separate ventilation system, tested communications, lighting, water, food, sewer, and a large pry bar in case of door blockage, and a firearm integrated into the safe room, is to allow survival until help arrives. Cell phones must be tested and probably will not work in steel safe rooms. first or second floor safe rooms, converted from the most strategically located bedroom, are intended to protect the family at night in case of home invasion. These feature a lighter version, bullet-resistant door. The walls are reinforced by adding Kevlar, laminated sheathing, bullet-resistant fiberglass, or other material. The same support items used in basement safe rooms should be installed in an upstairs safe room. An escape hatch up into the attic and out onto the rooftop might be considered in case of fire. An aluminum ladder could be left out on the roof for egress to the ground. Once away from the house, all should proceed to and remain at a pre-designated meeting place. Our comments on the movie Panic Room, starring Jodie Foster, appear in the email. Our first outside lighting slide shows lighting combinations that install on the corners of the house under the roof soffit. One lamp can illuminate one side of the house, as the other lamp illuminates another side of the house. The units pictured come with an adjustable motion detector that turns the lamps on and off. In pictures 1, 2, and 3 are shrouded incandescent lamps, unshrouded incandescent lamps, and a waterproof halogen lamp. Notice the picture of a replacement halogen lamp on top of picture 3. Pictures 4, 5, and 6 are types of fluorescent lamps. An outside fluorescent lamp in picture 5, and an inside fluorescent lamp in picture 6. In picture 1, we see a schematic of fascia and plastic soffit mounted on wood frame construction. If you have plastic soffit, you may have to mount the light on a roof beam. Picture 2 shows plywood soffit, the red dot, and painted wood fascia, green dot, over wood frame construction. Picture 3, the red dot, shows a prime location on the soffit for the installation of the outside lighting unit. Picture 4 has an inset of a lighting unit. If your apartment complex or condominium complex does not have outside lighting on every building, a group of residents should petition the management to have some installed. Let's read the notice. Ask your insurance company about approved alarm systems for your insured home. If you install an alarm system recommended by your insurance company, you may get a price break on the alarm system, plus get a reduction in your insurance payment. A wireless alarm system is not as much trouble as stringing wire throughout the house. Pictures 1 through 4, we have the master control, which is usually located in the basement or in a closet. The keypad arms and disarms the alarm system, selects various programs or select components to be armed or disarmed, and keeps a readout of the system condition. It also has alert buttons for fire, ambulance, and police. Next, we have a remote entry and the phone connection. Picture 5. Door or window breach sensor. Picture 6. The zoned motion sensor with adjustable sensitivity is arguably the most critical component of a home alarm system, as it is the one which detects silent entry if the door window breach sensor has been defeated. We suggest an adjustable motion sensor in each hallway, in each nighttime unoccupied zone, in addition to one facing each house entry door. A zoned motion sensor is one that detects a predetermined area or zone. Picture 7, known as a quote-unquote glass breaker, in each area of the house with windows, including the basement, is recommended. Also, a motion sensor and glass breaker in the garage is not a bad idea. Picture 8 is an external siren, which is placed unobtrusively on the outside of the house to let your neighbors know that you have been broken into. You could even have the installers demonstrate it to your neighbors so they know what to expect. Probably all of these systems should already be in your home if you have an alarm system. Pictures 1 through 3 is the smoke sensor, the carbon monoxide sensor, and the optional interior siren. We are including some remarks on radon gas. This gas is radioactive and is very carcinogenic. It is the second greatest cause of lung cancer after cigarette smoking. This deadly, colorless, odorless gas seeps out of the earth through cracks in the foundation and contaminates enclosed spaces. In picture 4, we have a schematic showing the pathways by which radon gas seeps into your home. There are different types of test kits, and each community should have a company that provides a testing service. Be sure to check with the BBB, the Better Business Bureau, on these testing services. The measurement of radon gas is expressed in picocuries per liter, or units of radiation that are 1/1,000,000,000th of a curie, a unit of radiation named after Madame Curie, one of the discoverers of radiation measurement. An acceptable standard of measurement says that anything over 2 picocuries per liter of air is caused to have a permanent and continuous ventilation system installed in your house. Optional equipment for your home alarm system. In picture 1 through picture 4, we have a moisture sensor to detect burst pipes, an internet connection in case you want to notify the alarm company or the police by internet, a door or window breach sensor / glass breaker combination, and a heat sensor. Entry door monitoring. In picture 5, we have the front door peephole, which we always thought was highly unreliable because it so distorted the face of a single person and did not identify anyone standing beside that person. Audio-video monitors. We have included websites in your email that sell audio-video monitors, which are comprised of A. The inside the door display monitor / transceiver with control panel. B. The outside the door video camera, microphone speaker combination, and doorbell. Remember, illumination for the outside video camera is critical. Never open doors to strangers or when you cannot see an image on the video screen.